There we go. So public-private partnership. This is a 10-mark question area waiting for you in the exam hall. Whether I like it or not, it is there. Question 4, A or B, we are going to be seeing public-private partnership there. Question 4 is with two things, 10-mark question on public procurement, and the other 10-mark question will come from public-private partnership arrangement. So we want to look at the first 10 marks area, which is the public-private partnership arrangement. It's an interesting topic. I can guarantee you, you're going to love it. It's very simple to understand. And once you understand the issues here, you can go into the exam hall and answer any question that the examiner is going to be providing you or asking you. So what exactly is public-private partnership? Now, you know that government has a primary responsibility. Okay, or if you want, public sector organizations have primary responsibility. The primary responsibility of government beyond ensuring that there is safety, that is national security, maintaining law and order, and all of those things, it's to be able to provide infrastructure facilities. Okay, infrastructure facilities. So we need good road network, we need better railway lines, we need, you know, better schools, all right? We need to have various other things, water facilities, okay? We need to have various factories spread across the country to ensure that people are employed and people are working very well at the end of the day. We need some network, you know, capabilities, towers, and all that to ensure. So these are all key infrastructure that is needed to increase the standard of living of the citizens at the end of the day, because we need better roads, we need better railway, we need better schools. Heck, we need some airports, you know, coming in to ensure that, I mean, the aviation sector is also working well, and other kinds of infrastructure facilities. So primarily, we pay taxes to the government. Government borrows money on behalf of the citizens. Government receive grants and all that to help to provide some of these infrastructure facilities to enable to improve the standard of living of citizens. But the thing that you must understand is that, say, for every one Ghana city of tax that you pay, about 90% of that goes into running the machinery of government. What does that mean? Because we have to pay wages and salary. There are training, there are per diem, the president is traveling somewhere. You could see the convoy, 35 and 40 fleet of vehicles, because they have to launch a certain factory somewhere, or there is a certain project somewhere that they have to outdoor or commission. And so there are fleets of vehicles and all of those things. So for every one Ghana city tax that you pay, it's likely that 90% goes into just running the machinery of government. So it means that about only 10 pesos is left for government to be able to then provide the road, the railway, the school, the water facilities, the factories, the network, the airports, and all the other infrastructure facilities needed to increase the standard of living of the citizens. Now, couple with this, government could go and borrow money, all right? So, but how much can government borrow? Government can only borrow so much to finance some of these infrastructure facilities. And currently, Ghana is under IMF program, and we are having problem with a second tranche of money being released. It's because a couple of things are not aligning very well because of our debt position as a country. So really, you realize that if we want to rely on the government to provide the needed infrastructure facilities, then development will never come in. The standard of living of the citizens will never increase. And so to solve this menace and this challenge generally, then there is a need to bring in the private sector. Because the private sector is going to be having the funding. The private sector is going to be having the technology. The private sector may have the technology and the necessary things that are needed to provide these infrastructure facilities. It is on this basis why the public-private partnership arrangement was introduced by the World Bank with support from various other countries to ensure that nations are able to have their infrastructure facilities. And that is the whole idea about public-private partnership arrangement. So it is where a public sector organization, or if you want, the government, who we will refer to as the contracting entity, enters into an arrangement with private sector entities to provide some of these infrastructure facilities that should have been the government's primary role to provide generally. That is all about public-private partnership arrangement. Now, just an aside, it is important for you to understand that sometimes two public entities could also come together to undertake a project. That is called public partnership. Okay? So two public organizations can also come together to execute a project. That is important because that way the two public institutions are going to be sharing the risk. It enables value for money to be achieved. To some extent, it reduces corruption in awarding of contract and other things. And so there are some benefits that governments get when two public organizations come together, and that is public partnership. But our focus really is going to be on when the government enters into an arrangement with the private sector. I've written public here again, with the private sector entities to undertake these projects. So what does the private sector bring on board? Like I said earlier, the private sector is going to be bringing on board the funding that we need. So sometimes the private sector is coming on board because they have the funding that we need for the projects generally that we want to undertake. Number two, sometimes it's just the technology, because sometimes we are bringing the private sector on board not because the government wants money, but because there is a technology that the government wants to leverage on. So the private sector could come in and we use their technology. It could be for our election, our voters register or database. It could be issues in relation to the general database management of the country. So we will bring in the private sector to undertake that project. Or sometimes it could just be looking at the expertise or skills. So the private sector brings on board the funding, the technology, the expertise to assist the public sector entities, which is the contracting entity, to undertake a project in that regard. Now, the question we then ask ourselves is, how does the private sector get paid at the end of the day? Because one thing you must understand is that public sector organizations primarily exist to maximize the welfare of citizens. But you and I know that the private sectors, they are not there to maximize welfare of any citizens. They are there to maximize the wealth of shareholders. So the two parties have different agenda, different goal, different objectives. So when the private sector is coming in with the funding or the technology or the expertise or the skills to partner with the governments to undertake a project that the government should have undertaken, they have to be paid. So the big question we then ask ourselves is, how do they get paid? There are three ways that they can be paid. The private sector can be paid. Number one, it could be service charges. So this is where the end users are going to be charged for using the service. So it could be a toll on a road somewhere. And so when you get there, you pay whatever amount. In our part of the world, Ghana, I think the tolls have been cancelled, but they are planning on bringing it back up. But that is an end user fee. Or if it is, say, a housing project, then it will be rented and tenants will collect the revenue or the rent income, and that will be their service fee in that case. So that's the first way they get paid, the service fees. Another way they get paid is through, you know, budget allocation, because sometimes not all projects can the private sector charge people for. So because sometimes some of the things are social good, so you cannot charge the end users for it. So in that case, there is going to be budget allocation every year for a number of years where the private individuals or private sector entities get paid. Or in some cases, it could be a combination of the two. It could be the combination of the two. What does that mean? It means that service charge a little, budget allocation a little. What does that mean? Let me give you an example. Let's say that government wants to reduce causes of diarrhea and various other health effects that comes from feces and others. And so government want to build a lot of public toilets available to the citizens. But then, you know, public toilets in some areas, that's going to cost money. Government doesn't have the money. So government can enter into that arrangement under the public-private partnership arrangement, so that the private sector entity will come and establish the public toilets. Now, they are going to be charging the end users who are going to be coming to use the public toilets. So this is just an example, okay? I mean, those days when we were in the village, there is nothing like public toilet. You want to poop, all you do is just go to the bush, sometimes dig the ground, and then you do your thing. There is a nice fresh air that is going to be passing around you, and it's like, oh, that's the best enjoyment you've ever had. So you go to such an environment, okay, then you have built a nice public toilet, then you are charging people, whatever, let's say 3 Ghana cedi or maybe 2 Ghana cedi for them to come and poop. What the heck? I mean, I can go to the bush and do my thing, have a natural air coming in nice for me. I'll feel better coming to use public toilets for 3 Ghana cedi or 2 Ghana cedi. In some cases, this 3 Ghana cedi or 2 Ghana cedis, I could get some few ingredients and I've prepared what we will call here ampesi, like some yam and some, you know, few things, and then boom, I have a meal with my 2 cedi or 3 cedi in the village, because literally you don't buy anything apart from basic ingredients that you would want to buy. And so how do we then motivate people so that they will still use the public toilets? So when the private sector is seeking to charge, say, 3 Ghana cedi, governments could step in and say, no, if you charge 3 Ghana cedis, these people are not going to be coming in. And so what do we do? Okay, the private sector is going to say, okay, I'm going to charge 1 cedi, or maybe 1 cedi 50 pesos. Then the government is going to absorb the remaining through annual budget allocation. So that is where both of the scenarios are coming in, and that is where the two issues can be possible. So how does the private sector get paid? The private sector entity gets paid through service charges, if it is possible, through budget allocation, or the two options, depending on the type of project that we are undertaking. Then the question we ask ourselves is, what are the principles that underline this public-private partnership arrangement? So say a government entity wants to enter into a project like this. So like I said, we want to have public toilets across the country, especially in the rural areas. And so we want to bring in a private sector entity who established this public toilets. What are the principles that we have to follow when entering into public-private partnership arrangement? So there are a couple of key principles that we need to understand when it comes to this issue about public-private partnership arrangement. The first one is called value for money. Value for money. You see, in the public sector, one of the fundamental issues is value for money. Value for money on the at the end of the day is ensuring that resources are obtained at the least cost, and we are utilizing them for their intended purpose. So for every PPP project, what we are saying here is that it shouldn't cost us more than it should have. So it should be competitive generally. That is why for most of the public-private partnership arrangements, unless otherwise not possible, government has to open it up so that various private sector entities can bid for the contract. That way, governments can select the best bid at the competitive price so we can get value for our money. And that is the first principle that each PPP project must adhere to. If something is done and another entity or another country is paying whatever, a $10 million for it, but we undertake that same thing and we are paying $12 million, that's too expensive. And sometimes it happens in this part of the world, in Africa, in some of these developing countries, because something that India would do under public-private partnership, and it will cost India, just an example, maybe $40 million under public-private partnership, a certain country will do the same thing. And they will say, oh, it is costing us 60 million. When India population is above a billion, like 1.5 billion, and the country in question, their population could be maybe 30, 40, or whatever, 50 million. So you ask yourself, what the heck is going on? Are we achieving value for money? That is the first principle. All PPP projects must achieve value for money. It means that they must not cost the country as much as possible. It should be a reasonable amount that we are paying for that particular contract. Not only that, in every PPP project, there are going to be a lot of risks. And so the arrangement must table out how risks are going to be allocated. So the second principle is risk allocation. The principle of risk allocation simply states that the party with the requisite skills or expertise should be responsible for the management of specific risks under the PPP project. Let's take that again. The party with the requisite skills or expertise in respect of a specific risk under the PPP arrangement should be required to manage that risk. So there are a lot of risks that a PPP project is going to be presenting. We have what we call construction risk, availability risk, maintenance risk, financial risk. All of these are types of risks that we are going to be facing under PPP project. The contracting entity, the government, will have the requisite or the expertise to manage some of the risk. Then the private sector will also have some expertise to manage some of the other risks, especially when it comes to issues about financing, because primarily the private sector is bringing in the money. Anything that relates to the financial risk, they're going to be the ones to put in place measures to mitigate any impact of the risks. That could be through insurance. Okay, so there are certain PPP projects, it will require that the entity or the private sector to have an insurance backing the deal, so that as the deal goes ahead, if you can't get the money, then probably we can get an insurance to come and pay for the rest, so we get our project going as a country. But risk allocation is the second principle that we have to know about. Number three is ability to pay. Remember, I told you that in certain PPP projects, one of the ways that the private sector gets their money back is through service charges. But like I told you earlier, you don't just get up and charge people anyhow. Under the PPP project, it is required that end users' purchasing power or ability to pay must be considered before charging them. So not that, yes, the private sector wants to maximize the wealth of the shareholders. The private sector wants to make money. So in the name of making money, let's leave them to charge any money they want to charge. No. You have to charge, but take into consideration the people's ability to pay. Because remember, if you charge it too high, nobody will come and your capital is gone down. So you have to be reasonable to consider the people's ability to pay. And so that is where, if it is not possible to compromise that by the private sector so that the project will be prolonged, then the government can step in to offer some subsidies through the annual budget allocation for the difference. Like the example I gave you earlier in terms of the public toilet. You want to charge me 3 Ghana cedi to come and poop? What is wrong with you? I'm in the village somewhere. Come on, I just take a cutlass and dig a hole and I do my thing. I cover it. Nice air blows around me. I feel comfortable. I come back home. Yeah, it's unhealthy. That's to you. In the village, it's healthy. We do it well. We do it nice. So you have to be careful with it. So don't come and say it's unhealthy. We do it well. So it's healthy to us. But so government will then come in and say, hey, listen, these people cannot pay 3 Ghana cedi to poop. Okay? So charge probably 1 Ghana cedi or charge 1.5 Ghana cedi. That is the principle that you must know about ability to pay. When end users are to be charged, the private sector entity must consider their ability to pay before they charge them. Number four is going to be the principle in respect of transfer of knowledge. This is one of the fundamental issues at the end of the day, because you see, for the most part, many of the PPP projects that government undertakes, a lot of these will end up bringing in foreign entities, foreign investors. So at the end of the day, in the PPP arrangement, it has to be structured in such a way that there'll be some knowledge transfer. So there has to be some capacity building for the locals, for the citizens, so that in the future, we can undertake that same project among ourselves, by ourselves, and we didn't have to bring a private person from outside a country, resulting into outflow of cash, outflow of capital, which will ultimately affect our foreign exchange as a country. And so it is important that we build into the public-private partnership agreement a plan by the private sector to transfer knowledge, to train people, to build the capacity of the locals to ensure that that knowledge is passed to them. So in the future, there will be some locals here who governments can engage for them to execute such contracts. That is another key principle that underlines the public-private partnership arrangement. The number five, it's going to be local content. This is also another crucial issue that comes in when it comes to the issue about public-private partnership arrangement, and that is local content. What does that mean? Like I told you earlier, many of the PPP projects, for the most part in this part of the world, will result into bringing in foreign entities, foreign investors into the country. Now, the local content principle is actually a legal framework which states that anything, any input that is needed for the project, which will be available or is available in Ghana, must be procured here in Ghana, so that we prevent the outflow of capital. Because many of these foreign entities, when they come, they would want to engage their partners, their fellow colleagues in their home country. And so when that happens, something that can be bought here, like the inputs that can be bought here, skills that are available here, they will not use it, because they would want to bring in people from their country so that all the money goes out there. To prevent that, there is the local content law, which mandates all PPP projects and various other activities that once the offer or once the inputs are available locally, they must be procured locally. What are we doing? We are revamping the economy. We are increasing our GDP locally. We are creating employment, and we are preventing outflow of cash, which will result into the negative movement in the foreign exchange rate, resulting into the further depreciation of the currency. So that is the local content principle as well in that case. So these are a number of principles that we can talk about generally when it comes to public-private partnership arrangement. Now, there are a list of them. I'm actually coming in from my book on public sector accounting and finance. And so I have a book on public sector accounting and finance. So primarily that is where I am coming in from. So you see value for money, risk allocation, ability to pay, local content. And we are looking at transparency. There are other principles there, like environmental, climate, and social safeguard. It is important that the public-private partnership project does not destroy the habitats, okay? Does not have a negative impact on the environment. And where it does, there has to be measures in place by the entity or the responsible parties to protect any negative impact on the government operations or government activities, on the environment generally at the end of the day. So the principles are a lot. We have accountability. You know, somebody must be held accountable for the contract that has been awarded. Somebody must be held accountable if something doesn't go in a manner that it is planned. Someone must be held accountable for every activity that is undertaken under the PPP project, so that in case something goes south, we can come in and question these people. So that is, or these are some of the key principles that guide PPP arrangement, and it's a 10 mark area that the examiner can throw at you in the exam hall, and it is important for you to understand. The big question we then ask ourselves is, what are the types of PPP projects? And this is also another 10 marks area that the examiner is going to be bringing to you. Now, there are about 7 types of public-private partnership arrangements. For the purpose of my presentation, I'm going to take them 2 by 2, then you see the way they operate. And I want you to stay with me here well, because like I said, it's a done deal area waiting for us in the exam hall. Number one, we're going to be talking about BOAT and BTO, okay? BOAT and BTO. What do we mean by BOAT and BTO? BOAT means we build, operate, and transfer. That is BOAT. Then BTO means build, transfer, and operate. Please stay with me. They are very simple. You're going to understand it. Now, what are these about? They are types of PPP. So, you know, a private sector is bringing in something and the public sector is bringing in something. But what are they about? In either case, what happens is that capital is going to be invested by the private entity. So capital investment by the private entity in both cases. Number two, in both cases, there is a risk sharing between the contracting entity and the public sector, the private sector entity in both cases. Okay, then number three, in both cases, the private entity or the private investor is allowed to operate the asset for a number of years to recoup their investment. So for starters, these are the 3 key features we can talk about. Whether it is build, operate, transfer, or build, transfer, operate, the private investor is bringing in the capital. There is going to be risk sharing between the two parties, the private investor and the public sector entity or the contracting entity. In both cases, the private investor is required to operate the asset for a number of years to recoup their investment. In both cases, also, it's a new asset that we are dealing with. It's a new asset. It's a new project that we are dealing with generally at the end of the day. So what is really the difference between the two? The difference is in the name and the way the arrangement is done. The first one is you build, operate, and transfer. So here, what happens is that under build, operate, and transfer, the private investor builds the asset. It's given the right to operate the asset for a given number of years. It could be between 25 to 30 years for them to recoup their investment. Then after that agreed number of years, the residual asset is transferred to the contracting entity. So transfer of the residual asset occurs at the end of the time agreed for the private investor to operate the asset. But under build, transfer, and operate BTO, what happens is that immediately the asset is ready, transfer is done. So the contracting entity will take ownership of the asset. Then the private entity is given the right to maintain, to operate the asset for a number of years to recoup their investment. That is the idea about the difference between the two. So it is in the name and in the structure of how these things are. So what are we saying? We are saying that here, transfer of the residual asset at the end of the agreed term. So transfer occurs at the end of the agreed term. But under the build, transfer, and operate, immediately the asset is completed, transfer is done. So transfer of the asset takes place. Immediately the asset is completed, all right, then the private sector entity, the private sector entity is given the right to operate the asset for an agreed period to recoup their investment. That is the idea about build, operate, transfer, build, transfer, and operate. Let's look at the second one. Mo, for Mohammed Kudus, or Mo Salah, and then SE, like say Supreme Court. So Mo here, it's going to be maintain and operate. That is Mo. Maintain and operate. SE here is going to be service concession. Now, stay with me. Stay with me. What is the similarities between the two? Maintain and operate, and then service concession. In either of these, number one, we are dealing with an existing asset. Okay, we are dealing with an existing asset. So there is already an asset. There is already an operation. There is already something that is there. However, that asset is operating at a low productivity level. So there is less productivity level for the entity or the operation or the project in question. So there's an existing asset. It's not that the asset is faulty. It's not that the asset is destroyed. It's there. It's being done. But there is less productivity. There is less efficiency there. That's the second thing that we need to understand. Then we bring in a private sector, and here the private sector entity, among other things, is required to increase the productivity or efficiency of the entity. So the private entity is required to increase productivity, or if you want, efficiency of the entity of the project. So whether we are dealing with maintain and operate or service concession, it's an existing asset. But the asset is not operating to its capacity. We are not achieving value for money. There is less productivity there. That's the second thing. The third thing is that the private sector entity is brought in to shake up the system and increase efficiency for us at the end of the day. So what is the difference between the two? Okay. The difference between the two is that in Mo, maintain and operate, it's an agency relationship. What does that mean? It means that something that a public sector entity previous was doing, now we bring in a private sector entity to come and do it. So it's an agency relationship. So now the private entity under maintain and operate is now acting as an agent, acting on behalf of the government. That's all. So it's an agency relationship. Number two is what I said earlier. The private entity only operates the asset without any capital investment because you're an agent. Because if you're an agent, you don't invest. So any money that is needed to ensure that the service will be rendered, any money that is needed to ensure that productivity is increased, any money that is needed for the day-to-day running of the affairs of the entity in question will be provided by the government or by the contracting entity. And so here there is no sharing of risks, because any risks associated with the asset is solely borne by the contracting entity. Because you're an agent, agents don't bear any risk. And usually this is a short period of time, less than 5 years. And so the private entity operates the asset for a fee. Okay, I could have brought that in, for a fee. So we pay them because they are agents. So we pay them to maintain the asset. How about service concession? Service concession also, there is an existing asset, like you know already. It is less productive. So we need a private sector entity to come and what? Shake up the system. But here, unlike Mo, where there was, it's an agency relationship, here, it's more than that. So here, the private investor or the private entity is required to both operate the asset as well as introduce capital. So you don't just operate it, you introduce capital. So here we say that the private entity is not only, the private entity is not only required to operate the asset, but also invest capital into the project. Now, because the private investor here it's not only operating but also bringing in some money, it means they will also bear some risks. So here, risk is going to be shared between the contracting entity and the private entity. Now, so because the private entity is bringing some money, they're going to bear some risk, then we need to give them more time to recoup their investments, right? So it is usually a long period of time, and it takes like, you know, a period of time. So it usually covers a long period, and that could be more than 25 years also. 20, 25, 30, 40 years. That is service concession. And there is an IPSAS that governs the way we deal with this. That is IPSAS 32. Recognition of assets under service concession. And we'll look at that later on IPSAS 32. But that is service concession. So the third one, so the first one was boats and BTO. Second one was more and SE. Third one will be BOO. Okay. If you remember my BOO and then ROT. BOO and ROT. Now, these guys have nothing in common. Like, they have nothing in common. They are in a different world all by themselves. So they have nothing in common, but, you know, just bringing them together for you to understand. So what do we have here? BOO means build, own, and operate. Okay, build, own, and operate. That's BOO. ROT means rehabilitate, operate, and transfer. So let's start with the BOO. Like the name suggests, the entity builds it, they own it, and they operate it. So under BOO, government gets nothing. What does that mean? Yeah, technically government gets nothing. A typical example of BOO is what you see in One District, One Factory. Under One District, One Factory, it's a typical example of public-private partnership arrangement under BOO. So under One District, One Factory, you are running your business or you have a business idea. Okay, you need some money. So here under BOO, government will, the contracting entity, let me put that down there, we can get it down so you get the idea. The contracting entity will provide, you know, support to the private sector. Now, what kind of support you may ask? It could be technical support, okay? It could be technical support or financial support. So here, there is no transfer at the end of anything because nothing ends anywhere. For instance, under One District, One Factory, the way the policy works is that you have a business. The business is doing well. You want to expand it. You want to grow the business. But you need money. Now, if you should walk directly to the bank and send them and say you want a loan from the bank may slap on you and say, hey, 40%. Why? Because the risk associated with your project is very significant. So the bank will say 40%. What's the One District, One Factory is doing as a public-private partnership project is that you bring your business plan and your proposal to the Ministry of Trade and Industry, as well as the Ministry of Special Initiative or whatever the heck at the Office of the President, and they will look at the proposal. Now, if they look at the proposal, they will find out, okay, how many jobs are you going to be created? Where is the firm going to be located? What will be the impact of those on our GDP? What will be the impact of your operation on maybe our balance of payment issue? Meaning that, like, we can export some of the things that you are doing. So there are some KPIs that the government will look at, the Ministry of Trade and Industry, and then the Ministry of Special Initiative or whatever the heck at the Office of the Presidency. They're going to look at all that. And then once you meet the criteria that the government is looking for such businesses, they now connect you with some of the providers of finance. Exim Bank, Agriculture Development Bank, and other financial partners under the One District, One Factory policy. And what then happens is that you are now able to get the money at an interest rate below what the commercial banks would have given you. So if you had gone, they would have given it to you at 40%, and that will even be difficult for you to get. But if you bring your proposal, they study the proposal, look at the proposal, it meets the various criteria, the job, how it will impact our economy, where it is located, how it will impact our balance of payment position as a country generally, and the general contribution to the general economy, you can get that loan at, say, whatever, 25%. What happens? It means that you get a reduction in the interest rate by what? 15%. That is going to be paid to the providers of finance through budget allocation. So that is the idea about BOO. So the private investor owns everything and there is no transfer. But like I said, it's a system put in place so that we can empower the private sector to expand in their businesses, start new businesses, create jobs, help to solve the balance of payment challenge, increase our GDP, and increase the standard of living generally of the citizens. So what does government get in return? Government gets the accolades of creating job. Government gets the opportunity to pride itself with the fact that we are exporting some of the produce, and governments get a pride to say that we are able to control the balance of payment position, thereby ensuring that the Ghana cedi doesn't depreciate further than it has depreciated. That is the idea about BOO. So let's come to ROT. ROT is rehabilitate, operate, and transfer. Again, you see, in the name, everything is there already. So rehabilitate. What does it mean to rehabilitate? Rehabilitate means there is something already there. That thing is out of operation. You come in and revamp it. Then we allow you to operate it for a number of years to get your money back. Then give us our thing back because it's always been ours. That is rehabilitate, operate, and transfer. So the clue here is that here we have an existing asset, or it could be a factory, and that existing asset or factory requires a revamp. So it's out of operation and requires a revamp. So revamp because it has been out of operation. So what do we do? We bring in a private entity, or a private investor is allowed to invest capital to revamp and operate the asset for a number of years to recoup their investment. You know, they spent some money. And after the expiration of that, the residual asset is transferred to the contracting entity. That is rehabilitate, operate, and transfer. The last one is debuilt. That is design, build, and operate. It's a specialized model. And again, just let me go to my slide for you to see. So you can see types of PPPs here. So I'm coming in primarily from my book on page 200 here. You can see the explanation, the key features, some examples of how each of these ones run generally. So debuilt, design, build, and operate. So it's a specialized contract usually where this time around, designing and building of the facility are done based on a 10 key basis. That is, the contractor takes total responsibility for the design and execution of the project. Now, in the previous types, the previous types that we have identified, the design and everything, the government knows how to do it, and so they just give you the guidelines on what you're supposed to do. But in debuilt, you are going to start everything from scratch as a private investor because you take total control over everything. And so, because sometimes these are, like I said, one of specialized projects that the government has no expertise, much knowledge in, but it's something that probably you have proposed. And so they will leave the design, building it, and they will allow you to operate it for a number of years. Then at the end of the day, the residual asset is transferred to the contracting entity. These are the types of public-private partnership arrangement or models of public-private partnership arrangement.